The focus on this segment is on the country of Sri Lanka. Historically, the United States has always had issues with the island country's offensive against the LTTE. However, the end of civil war in 2009 seems to have brought in a bit of a thaw in that stand, but Sri Lanka has also been warming up to China, something that the new US dispensation might not take kindly to. To discuss this and more, we are joined by our guest from Colombo, Tamara Kunanayakam. She is, of course, the UN Independent Development Expert and, of course, a former diplomat. In the studio here, I am joined by my colleague and senior international correspondent, Padma Rao, who also happens to have authored a book on Sri Lanka. Good evening to both of you, and thanks so much for joining us. I'm being told that Tamara is not with us right now, so let's get the conversation started here itself. Padma, you've tracked Sri Lanka very closely. Sometimes it seems that the conversation with India and Pakistan seems to overshadow processes really in South Asia. But how important is the Sri Lanka question when we look at South Asia and the new US president?
It's always been very important, Aisha, because Sri Lanka is located at a very strategic junction of the Indian Ocean. It is located exactly where the important oil tankers pass through. And Colombo port is very, very important, especially also for for Indian ships. 80% of India's cargo flows through Colombo. So it's been very important, not only in the region, but also internationally for many countries, because almost every country's interests, as you know, would be at stake if somebody were to hold up those oil tankers or if something were to happen there. So the US has a twin interest in the region. One is the Indian Ocean region, and as you rightly pointed out, to contain China to an extent, because China is also sprawling all over the Indian Ocean, and also to pursue a tighter relationship with Sri Lanka, a closer relationship with Sri Lanka, and possibly make Sri Lanka such a close strategic ally that it would help the United States in its venture in the Indian Ocean region.
All right. We're told that Tamara Kunanayakam is joining us right now from Colombo. First of all, good evening and thank you so much for joining us here on WEON. Tamara, firstly, how do you look at the outgoing Obama dispensation's relations with Sri Lanka?
Well, I think there is an impression that the policy of the U.S. had changed following the end of the civil war in 2009, and that it had become more friendly and more open towards Sri Lanka. But I think this is not the correct perception, because Sri Lanka, even after the end of the war in May 2009, the U.S. continued to exercise pressure on Sri Lanka under the previous government, and it's continuing to do that under the present government. As you know, in the United Nations, at the Human Rights Council, there were attempts already in September 2011, that's when I was there, they tried to move a resolution through Canada. And when they didn't succeed, when they couldn't get sufficient support, Canada withdrew it. And the US, it was a US draft. And in the same way, they tried to put through the Darusman panel report, which is a report of a personal advisory group of the Secretary General, which alleged that Sri Lanka had committed war crimes. And so this is still on. This pressure is still on the government, and it is still on, even though we have a new government in Sri Lanka in place, which is the servile government, servile to Washington's interests. But at the same time, I think the Washington is not very secure about the future, and many things can happen. The pressure can come from the opposition or from the people on the street. So I think they will keep the pressure on just to be sure.
I have a question for Tamara. Tamara, you mentioned that you don't think that U.S. relations or the U.S. is particularly thawed towards Sri Lanka, and you did rightly point out to the 2011 resolution. But you would, what I've been hearing in Sri Lanka is that there have also been joint military exercises. Those are being steeped up. There are joint naval exercises. Arms imports by the Sri Lankan armed forces from the United States have also been on the increase. So would you say that the U.S., be it Hillary or be it Clinton, and then I'd like you to, I beg your pardon, be it Hillary Clinton or Trump, would you like to tell us how that relationship, the defense relationship, the strategic relationship that the United States is trying to build with Sri Lanka is likely to pan out under each candidate. If Hillary wins, what's going to happen to that? If Trump wins, what's going to happen?
I'll first respond, Padma, to your first question. That I know, I think we were cut off for a short while, so I didn't fully follow what you said, but I think you were referring to the Asia-Pacific region and the US policy in that region, its pivot to Asia strategy, which is to contain China. I think we'll have to look at this, what's going on in Sri Lanka, and the relationship that the present government has with the US is linked to that global, much larger, broader global strategy, which is focusing on the Asia-Pacific region. I would like to remind you that the US Navy announced recently that by 2020, it will concentrate 60% of its naval and air forces in the Asia-Pacific region. And the commander of the US Pacific Command has pointed to the importance of the South China Sea for this purpose. And he says that this is a fundamental principle of the US is to protect that region. Now, I also heard you saying about the economic interests and why they want to protect the maritime trade routes. The Admiral Harris, again, the commander of the Ship Pacific Command, said that more than.
All right, we seem to be having a bit of an issue connecting with Tamara there. There seems to be some sort of freeze taking place, but we will, of course, go back to her. But Padma, you know, when, for instance, when we talk about the United States and Pakistan, India always figures. But when we're talking about United States and Sri Lanka, of late, it seems that China has become a huge part of that conversation. Is that going to prove to be an irritant to U.S. and Sri Lanka relations going forward, irrespective of really who comes to power?
Yes, you're absolutely right, Aisha. China has a very close relationship to Sri Lanka. I wouldn't call it a very close political relationship yet, but it's certainly Sri Lanka is steeped in debt currently, and most of this debt is from because of the, you know, the amount of money that China has pumped into Sri Lanka over the years. So so that is going to be an irritant. That is already an irritant because the United States also, let's not forget, has its largest overseas military base in Diego Garcia, which is also in the Indian Ocean, and it seeks to also keep an eye on rising Islamic Wahhabi fundamentalism in the Maldives and overall in the South Asian region.
Right.
So I think what the United States is trying to do, and this is what diplomats, my friends, you know, former diplomats in Sri Lanka tell me, is that one of the things they're trying to do is to create a kind of a either co-opt India or co-opt China. Sri Lanka into the strategic relationship that they want to build in the Indian Ocean region, obviously with the focus being China's own sprawl, known more commonly as the String of Pearls strategy. So yes, China will certainly play a role, but of course it remains to be seen, and I'd like to ask Tamara, who is likelier to go softer on which country in the region, and which who is likelier to not do so between Clinton and Trump?
Well, in fact, I'm being told that Tamara is back with us. So, Tamara, if you heard Padma's question, could you please go ahead and answer that for us?
Yeah, let me come back because I was interrupted earlier on. I would like to confirm that there's been very close nexus being developed, political and military, between the present Sri Lankan government and Washington. We've had, in terms of political visits, we've had more top U.S. State Department people, including the Secretary of State John Kerry, Biswal Malinowski, Secretary of the U.S. Navy, who have visited Sri Lanka more than it has happened in all our history. And also in terms of military, we've had the visits of the USS Frank Cable from the Pacific, we've had USS New Orleans, U.S. 7th Fleet, and we've had exchanges, training programs of Navy personnel in Diego Garcia. I would like to point to three significant events, though. One is the statement of the Sri Lankan Prime Minister in April this year, where he said at a Naval Academy meeting that Sri Lanka will have to play a role in protecting the sea routes, and I think this is important to highlight, across the Indian Ocean, the Pacific Ocean, the Sea of Banda Aceh, and the Straits of Malacca. and at the same time, the Pacific Command, Harris, Admiral Harris, is reported to have said that now that Sri Lanka is with us, it should be possible for a major naval base to be established in Sri Lanka, which will complete the ring that was not filled in the north of the Indian Ocean region. Now, there's another third important event is apparently there's a cabinet decision. It's not made public that they have decided to allocate at a time when we are at peacetime and there is we are looking for money outside, as Padma pointed out. We have allocated $400 million for the purchase of jet planes and $300 million to upgrade armaments. Now, on the question of what will change if depending on who wins in Washington, I think we shouldn't have illusions about it, because the U.S. foreign policy is formulated and controlled by an oligarchy and the neoconservatives and the brain trust. So there is Robert Kagan, Wolfowitz, Richard Perle, and we know who they are. They are the theoreticians of the project for the new American century. So I don't think there's going to be a big change. And right. Whether it is Clinton who remains or whether Trump comes in, it won't change. And I think what is important for us as Sri Lankans is the only option that we have is to pursue an independent and sovereign foreign policy. And for that, we need to have an independent and sovereign economy.
Right. So it seems from our conversations with the people in Sri Lanka, Pakistan and India itself that really speaking, how South Asia ends up, you know, having a relationship with the U.S., it really depends on South Asia itself. Who does end up coming into power doesn't have that much of an impact on foreign policy between the two countries. So far as Sri Lanka and USA goes, as Tamara is pointing out. We're going to take a quick break, but when we come back, we're going to talk more about the domestic issues in Sri Lanka, of course, the question of Tamil expats as well, all that and more. Pardon me, I dropped my pen. We'll be back shortly. Stay with us.